is it, Chuck, that people can't seem to get when we talk about climate change? I mean, this conversation has been going on for years. People came before you and I warning us, mm-hmm. sounding the alarm, and yet people, they didn't really get it.
Well, I think the problem with climate change is that it's a very big issue. And for the most part of the discussions around climate change, it has been confined to the circles of people who are mainly working on environmental advocacy. And sometimes that language focuses on the language of science and policy. Whereas climate change is not just an environmental issue, it's also a social justice issue, it's also an economic issue. It's all those things at once. And when we start to talk about climate change, I think it's important that we think about frames. Like, how do we frame issues? Mm-hmm. How do we frame climate change? Because people come from different contexts, and we as advocates should be aware that people come from different contexts, and people, particularly in this region, have a finite pool of worries, given that our country is also beset with a whole lot of other issues and problems.
So let me jump off from that. If you talk about the Philippine context, we have a myriad of issues that we need mm-hmm. to contend with. We're also one of the world's most vulnerable nations.
That's
when
true.
It comes to climate change. So how do you then get that concept and make people understand what this really is all about?
Well, we make them understand by speaking from where they're at. People are actually looking at climate change from science, but science tells us that climate change is something that is very graspable. When we experience the weather, we are experiencing climate change. When a farmer's yield declines because of prolonged droughts, it's because of climate change. Fisher folk has less catch, it's because of climate change, because climate change induces the warming of the oceans.
When we talk about the biggest carbon mm-hmm. emitters in the globe, there's a huge swath of space there.
Yes.
How do you connect both? How do you tell the farmer it's because of them, but then you also have to do something?
Well, it's talking about the issue of climate change. I mentioned earlier that it's all-encompassing. And because climate change is all-encompassing, we should also take note that climate change is an intersectional issue, and that people who are already working for social justice agendas in different sectors should look at climate change as something that binds them, like their win for their specific sector's interest is actually in the interest of the fight to combat climate change.
And you're hoping to build a world of community-led renewable energy for all. How do we get there? How do you intend to get there?
Well, for 350, we have three ways where we're looking at shifting from fossil fuels towards 100% renewable. First, we believe that we should start by shifting financial flows. 350 is at the forefront of the divestment movement. It's a movement of students, of different people from all sectors, calling on the financial sector to shift their investments from fossil fuels towards community-based renewable energy solutions. It's also calling for export credit agencies for public finance to defund existing projects, so that we can shift money from investments that do not profit people and the planet towards solutions that not only build a better world but also build a just society.
But when you do that, mm-hmm. when there's a shift, there's always fear that
yes.
goes with it, especially if it means fear of losing money, fear of losing income, fear of losing jobs as well when you get into mm-hmm. that shift. So what is your argument regarding that?
Well, on the onset, it might seem costly because it means shifting the way we live. But in the long run, if you look at how climate change is already impacting us, we are already experiencing the cost of climate change. And a lot of it are actually costs that do not reflect on the accounts books because they are externalized. It impacts the health of people. It impacts the ecosystems. It impacts the long-term investment trajectory of countries. Because if you look at it from the perspective of climate change, things are bound to get worse. And if things are bound to get worse, it means you're investing on something that eventually you wouldn't even earn a profit. So climate change is more about investing. So that's what the divestment movement is calling
on. Is that how you speak when you're before business leaders, when you're before policymakers, financial leaders, and do they get it?
Well, we speak together with people who are more eloquent and are more well-versed in the language of policy and finance. And I think there's a global trend that people are getting it. They're starting to get it. There are players in the financial sector that are shifting already their investments towards low carbon solutions. We can think of insurance agencies, we could think of banks changing the way they invest, like putting safeguards on how their projects impact environment, impact the climate. So there's that direction already. And in the long run, if you look at the energy sector, there's a shift in the trajectory of how energy is being used now in the energy mix of the global and in the global energy mix, you can see that the prices of renewable energy, the prices of solar panels are on the decline. Right. So if people who are still peddling fossil fuels are still investing in it, they would be investing on something that eventually they wouldn't earn a profit. But the problem is that since it's already invested cost and people have already put in money on it, it would be stranded assets and eventually it would be us. The consumers would be paying the price for bad investment choices.
Well, recently, when you talk about, you know, talking to business leaders and you think that they're beginning to get it, just recently, there are some people who were saying, I think this is also discussed in the ADB, that if businesses want to stay relevant, then they're going to have to look into climate change, address that, and be part of the solution to this crisis.
Yes, that's true. Climate change, because of how big it is, it's actually, if you look at it, it's not just a crisis, it's also an opportunity. It's an opportunity to align how we live and work in such a way that we live in harmony with our environment.
How can you not take that step forward together with the other climate warriors? But as we speak, Chuck, there are still coal plants that are about to be built. They're in the pipeline, and countries like Japan are willing to pay for the building of those coal plants. What are you going to do with that?
Well, we're going to be confronting Japan with their investment choices. We'll be confronting them on every front. And that's, in fact, one of the reasons why 350 has been involved in pushing Japan as the chairman of the G20 to shift, to show climate leadership by shifting their investments from coal and fossil fuels towards renewable energy solutions.
Climate emergency now. And how declaring it would greatly help the situation. You know, there's more left to be desired, but already we're hearing of, you know, the British Parliament, New York, at least two cities in France, declaring a state, a climate emergency. State the case for us, Chuck. We're not as big as the biggest in the world. In fact, we're not as big as the biggest emitter in the world, but in fact, we're one of the most vulnerable nations to climate change. So why must we declare a climate emergency?
Well, declaring climate a climate emergency means that we are treating climate change for what it is, a crisis. And it means that if it's a crisis, we shouldn't be going on the trajectory of business as usual. For the case of why the Philippines should be calling for a climate emergency, I think it's very simple in the sense that we should be declaring a climate emergency. We should be reflecting that in our energy policy. We should be reflecting that in the whole governance of the country, because if we do not do so, we reinforce the same inaction of the historical and per capita emitters with regards to climate change.
What will it look like?
Well, I think it would look like that the government would be responsive to the demand to put ambitious and urgent action on climate change. It means putting away the blockade of bureaucracy for actions that benefit the community, that benefit the planet. And for us at 350, we believe that the government's seriousness on climate action should be reflected in its energy policy, which at the moment is still purely dependent on fossil fuels.
It will mean loss of jobs, or will it? Will it mean loss of income?
Well, it would mean that they would have to be smarter. It would mean that they would be thinking for more forward thinking than what they are doing now. When we talk about climate change and the displacement of labor, there's this principle called just transition. It means that the phase out of fossil fuels wouldn't be abrupt. It would mean transitioning the workforce, transitioning the current infrastructure of fossil fuels towards what is suitable for the community.
Are you telling us, Chuck, tonight that it can actually be good for the economy and not be detrimental to the economy?
Yes, that's true. climate action benefits not only people and the planet, it benefits the economy in general, because a healthy planet translates to a healthy economy.
We touched about this a while ago. We touched about, you know, how you ended up in this fight. It came naturally for you. You came from a family that's already woke, to use the millennials term. You knew what to fight for. You were well versed in these issues already. And being an artist, you also expressed that through your work. But for ordinary people, Chuck, why should they take up this fight? Because by the way you were talking, it's sort of existential already. It's come to that.
Mm-hmm. Well, people should take up the fight because in the long run, it would affect them. But also it means standing up for what you stand on. And we all stand on the earth. And the earth is something that's at threat. And I think that's what we should be standing on, because it means not only standing on for what we stand on, but also it means standing up for the things that we care and the people that we love.
As I said, it's a worldwide movement. 350.org is mm-hmm. a worldwide movement. Tell us about the gains that this movement has given the earth, has given the planet, because these people really chose to fight this fight.
Well, 350.org is started from humble beginnings. It started with a group of students from Middlebury College, who are, I think, students Bill McKibben, who gathered together to think about what do we need to push when we talk about climate change. And they remembered the figure of 350, as according to the history, is that it's the safe number of carbon dioxide that allows life to thrive in its diversity.
Truth is, the alarm has been sounded, as I said, many mm-hmm. years ago, and it landed on deaf ears. And now we're running out of time. So if things continue as they are, if, to borrow your words, it's business as usual, what kind of planet will we see in the very near future?
Well, if things go to business as usual, science says that we would be breaching climate tipping points. Some scientists say that if we breach those tipping points, it would mean an end for the compatibility of human civilization with its environment as we know it. And some say that it's beyond scientific models. And that's, I think, what a lot of international treaties are fighting against. Like, the fight for climate change is still an intergenerational problem. And scientists have given dire warnings. Last year, they released the special report on 1.5 degrees Celsius, which basically indicates that we shouldn't breach 1.5 degrees, mm. because that would mean runaway climate change. And I think that has spurred a lot of organizing momentum within the movement. Like, you would see youth spending Fridays walking out of their classes to protest and call for climate emergency.
Thank you for watching. For more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.